again. We gather here this evening to celebrate Christ's child coming into the world. For any other year, and for many, this is a joyous season filled with presents and candy, shopping and music, family and friends. For others, it can be the most difficult time of year. Many people carrying pain they neither share nor show, going through the holiday motions, trying to make it past another New Year's Eve. Many of us have faced a loss this year, the loss of a loved one, the loss of a job, the loss of an expectation. In the midst of the unknown, we see loss, questions, and tension. The unknown comes any time we do something new or face something different. It can be exciting when we get our first car, or go to a new school, get married, start a job, go somewhere new. The unknown can make us nervous. Many of the same things mentioned above. Being in a strained relationship, facing unemployment for the first time, starting a new career path, or being diagnosed. And the unknown can be exhausting. Not knowing how you'll pay your bills, going through a global pandemic, going through a tense election, not knowing if you'll see your loved one again. The list goes on. But many of us have faced unknowns before, and God showed up in new ways so that we can grow in our trust in Him. Though we come as individuals, each with our own burden or struggle, we come together to seek Christ, Emmanuel, God with us. The light in our darkness, the hope in our pain, the comfort in our mourning. We come together to seek the light, to be present in our loss, present in the unknown, and present with one another. And it's in that very presence that we see Jesus. For He said, "Wherever two or three are gathered in My name, there I am in their midst." We will begin tonight by lighting the Advent candles for our loss of a loved one, of an expectation, of a season of life, or the loss of a job. We light the first candle to remember the loss of a loved one. Maybe it was a parent or a grandparent, a spouse, one of our children, an aunt, an uncle, a friend or co-worker. Father, You know who we think of at this time. We can feel lost, isolated, sad. We can feel at peace or discontent. As we light this candle, Lord, we ask that You be present in our loss. We light the second candle to remember the loss of a life season. There are times in life where that season becomes our identity, whether it's being a child, a student, a parent, a spouse. People that provided for us are no longer here or need to be independent. Or can no longer help us. There are times when we lose that season and we no longer who we are, who we're supposed to help. So Lord, we ask that you be present in that loss of season, in that time of uncertainty. It could be the loss of a job or a career. Especially in this time and in this place, maybe the company restructured. We were let go, we left on our own accord, or simply retired. For many of us, our job is our identity. And when that is threatened or lost, a number of emotions come with it. Sadness, anger, relief, joy, freedom, anxiety. Even in retirement, people face a certain anxiety because we get used to the daily rhythms. Lord, we ask that you be a constant presence in the waves of emotion and questions. We light our fourth candle to acknowledge the loss of an expectation. We had expectations for this year. This Thanksgiving, this election, this Christmas. Many of us have adjusted our lives in one way, shape, or form to keep working, to keep our kids in school, to care for a loved one, even to gather together. Somehow, we are physically tired, emotionally strained, and spiritually depleted at times. Yet the Lord is ever present, and we ask him to join us in our unmet expectations. Our fifth candle is the Christ candle. In the midst of the questions, the emotions, the challenges and adjustments we make navigating the unknown, we invite Christ to come. Be present with us and shine your light, the light of life, the light of hope, the light of peace into our lives. May we be reminded that like the flickering candlelight, even when it seems you are quiet, you are still here, present with us now. You can stay seated for the call to worship, but would you please join me for the call to worship? Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn.
Sometimes it feels as though God is far from me.
Far from my cries, my grief, my pain.
My prayers go unanswered, my loss too great to bear. One thing I recall, and this brings me hope. Jesus wept, he comforted, bringing hope and joy to those who would follow.
He will never leave nor forsake us.
Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Amen.
I say, fire, fire, fire.
First scripture for tonight is 2 Corinthians 1, 3 through 7. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ. But if we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. Or if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which is effective in the patient enduring of the same sufferings which we also suffer. And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our sufferings, so also you are sharers of our comfort." Let's have a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for tonight. I thank you for your Spirit here. I thank you for the work of the cross. I thank you for Christ entering into our world. I pray, Lord, that you allow your Spirit to move freely among us, to know that you are near. And that, as you said, blessed are those who mourn, that you bring your comfort through your Holy Spirit. That in this time of unknown, we rest at ease and we rest in peace, knowing that you are in control, accomplishing your will through those who follow you. We thank you, Father. We lift this to you in Christ's name. Amen. Our second scripture is found in Luke 2, verses 25 through 32. "And there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to carry out for him the custom of the law, then he took him into his arms and blessed God and said, 'Now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. So I welcome you to this Blue Christmas service. A Blue Christmas service allows us to acknowledge the pain, acknowledge the loss in this season, acknowledge the unknown. We have a sign up front that says blessed, and two hanging lights that represent tears that came to mind when we read this passage. Blessed are those who mourn. And tonight we're going to walk with a man named Simeon. He worked in the temple with Anna, or he served in the temple with Anna, whom we met on Sunday. Before that, I saw a post that a friend posted the other day and decried the lack of redemption in a series of stories, a series of books that she was reading. And when she got to the final book in the series, the redemption finally came, but it was brief, it was short-lived, and it felt incomplete. And it struck me, there is something within the human spirit that seeks redemption. We want the tension resolved. We want the good and the bad characters in the movie to see justice. We want the wrong and the oppressed restored. We want the mourner comforted. And we read in Matthew, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. So who was Simeon? As we look at the scripture, we see three traits about him. He was a righteous man. It means he was right standing with God. He was devout. He was sincere and devoted in his time, energy, and focus to serve the Lord. And the Holy Spirit was on him, like a prophet of old. For it was revealed to him that he would not see death until he saw the Lord's Christ, God's anointed one. So what did he seek? It says he sought the consolation of Israel, seeing the God's anointed one to restore Israel from under the oppressive Roman regime. And many of us know Isaiah 43. It's John's cry, John the Baptist, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. But not as many of us are familiar with the first two verses that precede that. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Simeon sought comfort and peace, double that of the sin of his brothers and sisters. No more living in fear, no more zealots or tax collectors, one nation, Israel, living under one God. And when did Christ appear to him? Luke tells us that Simeon came to the temple in the spirit to carry out the custom according to the law. How many baby boys did Simeon circumcise and bless in this ritual, in his ritual activities? How many weeks did he wait to see the coming of Christ? Was it weeks or months? Was it months or years? He served in the temple with Anna. And I wonder, did they discuss the coming of Christ together? Did the Holy Spirit reveal to them at one time or at different times? Did this ever come up in conversation? Or did they just keep it to themselves? You see, Christ showed up in the routine, the ritual, to restore, reconcile, and make all things new, to shine light in the darkness. And even as a baby, he was recognized for who he was by the devout the righteous, the humble, and patient. And how does Simeon respond? He says he can now depart in peace because God is the God of his word. Not only was the Savior for the nation of Israel, but also a light of revelation to the Gentiles. He came only not to restore Israel, but to restore all people, to reconcile all people back to God. Jesus came into the world that whosoever shall believe in him shall have eternal life. No matter the trials, no matter the waiting, no matter our short or narrow view, God's plan will be carried out exactly when it needs to happen. And it's in the everyday routine. It's in the everyday ritual that when we seek Christ, he appears and accomplishes his will and gives us that peace that the world cannot give, nor can it take away. So in the loss, as we seek consolation, whether it's for ourselves, whether it's for our nation, whether it's for our family, may we have the rest and resolve to maintain our focus on Christ until he shows up and makes his will known and brings us that comfort. Now, in the bulletins, you'll find a little sticky note. And if you're at home with us, if you can grab a pen and paper, what we'd like to do with these notes is to name one or two losses this year. Maybe it's the death of a loved one. Maybe it's the loss of an expectation, the loss of a job. As you listen to this next video, I invite you to write that loss down. Name it in the presence of those here. And take it to the Lord in prayer. When the video ends, I'll read scripture and invite you to lay them at the foot of the cross as you leave at the end of the service. But now, please, take time. Pray, write, and invite Christ in.
It's been
and read the first 5 verses found in John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. As you leave tonight, I invite you to leave your loss at the foot of the cross in the narthex. Afterwards, take a lighted candle as a reminder of the hope that we carry, the light that shines in the darkness. Christ comes into the everyday routine, and he is present now, in the loss, in the unknown. Indeed, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Amen. Thank you for joining us tonight.